Hello everybody, this is Pierre from Starfighters Aerospace. We are here today at the Kennedy Space Center in front of the RLV hangar, which is also the home base for Starfighters Aerospace, the only commercial operator in the world that operates Lockheed F-104s available for commercial operations. We currently have seven of them airworthy, and the company is owned by Mr. X Fetkov. We're gonna walk around the airplane today and see some of the features of the aircraft from the outside, and then we're gonna also have a quick run around the cockpit with the power on it. So we're gonna see a few things moving or light on. It's a Lockheed TF-104GM. It's one of the latest F-104s that was in operation with an Air Force, which was Italian Air Force, all the way to 2005. The company owns four of the Italian Air Force, former Italian Air Force airplanes, the most updated F-104s in existence. Lockheed F-104s, they've been designed, as you know, in the middle 50s and quite ahead of their time. It was a supersonic aircraft designed for high subsonic cruise and supersonic combat. So an aircraft that was extremely capable back then, and because of his features and its envelope, it's still one of a kind today, and it's very useful for specific niches of today's aviation and aerospace industries. This specific aircraft, it's a two-seater. That's why TF-104, training F-104. G is the basic model that it came off of, and the M is a later modification that you received from the Italian Air Force with some avionics wiring and systems a little more updated. We're gonna start walking from the front of the aircraft in the very pointy nose and radome, which obviously starts with the very long pitot probe. Back in this era, this is obviously a Mach 2 plus aircraft, or Mach 2 aircraft. So the pitot tube, the reason why it's sticking out so much is so it was outside of any interference of the frame itself. So the data and the air pressures measured right here are not interfered by any other shockwave or part of the aircraft itself. So that's why it's sticking out that much. Back here, that's a radome. It's obviously made in glass fiber, so it's radio transparent. There's a radar inside, still functional. Antennas, transponder antennas. This is the angle of attack probe on the right side. This one here, it's connected to their data computer and a three-axis computer, it's so-called. There are avionics, avionic boxes back in the avionic compartment. So it measures an angle of attack, which then the computers elaborates depending on the configuration and the speed and the altitude, and provides the pilot with some angle of attack indication. And on top of that, they control the APC, which is a system that provides a shaker and kicker on the controls for stall awareness to the pilot. Going back here, we can see a curious thing about this aircraft. Here on the bottom, there's two hatches, one from the front seat and one from the back seat. Curiously enough, the first version of the F-104 had downward ejection seats. At that time, technology didn't allow to build an ejection seat that would be efficient enough and be fit in the small room that they had to be able for the pilot to eject and clear the detail in the whole envelope of the aircraft. So since they weren't able to do that, the first ejection seat were ejecting downwards, which was very curious and unusual. If an ejection at low altitude was necessary, like right after takeoff, the technique from the flight manual was supposed to be to roll the aircraft upside down and then eject. So at least it wasn't, the pilot was not going to be ejected towards the ground, but away from it. That didn't last very long. And finally, they got to a point that the seat was actually designed and be able to be fit in the space that was available. So then the Lockheed C2 seat, these aircraft, the former Italian Air Force One, they're fit with Martin Baker's Jackson seat, much more efficient, modern, and updated. All right, so now we keep moving towards the right side, towards the back. Here, just outside the cockpit, there's two small ports, one here and one there. Those are the fresh coops for fresh air in case of pressurization malfunction and or getting rid of smoke in the cockpit. They can be opened from the inside and they automatically cut off the pressurization system. Back here, that's the lever to open the canopy. Both of them are connected together. So from the ground to unlock them, that's the lever to unlock them. And when we close them, that's the same lever is used to lock them back. Back here, that's a probe for the air data computer, more antennas, ADS-B and transponder. This is the electric compartment here. So This aircraft is mainly AC aircraft, meaning that the aircraft has a main AC alternating current system at 400 Hertz, 115 volts, three phases. That's why all the switches we see here, or breakers, let's call them, they're all three phases. So one single switch moves three phases, okay? All of the main systems are, they all come here. This will be the fuel pumps, flaps, actuators, pressure suits, radar amplifiers, and power units, and so forth. These are big three-phase relays we can see. You can actually hear them in the cockpit when the electric system comes on. There's a big bump, and that's between hydraulic valves that move in the correct position and the relays jumping in the correct position. As soon as the engine reaches idle, the generators come online, so that's a big bump that you can feel in the aircraft structure, actually. Back here, two very small batteries, so the DC portion, direct current portion of the aircraft, it's extremely small. Only few items use direct current. There's two very small batteries, one is here, one is there. So these two very small batteries, those are basically 4 amps battery, 28 volts. They only provide DC power to a very few systems in the aircraft, in just in case the AC systems or the AC power is not available for whatever reason, or on the ground like right now. So right now, if we were to walk in the cockpit, the only things that work with the aircraft not running and not connected to an external power unit, like we're gonna see later, the only things that work is the emergency UHF for a few seconds, or for let's say a few minutes, the igniters, which you can even hear them, and actually I'll do that in a second. I'm gonna show you them what you hear from here. That's one of the tests you do before power is applied to the aircraft to make sure that they're all working, and the fire lights. So the only things that come on in the cockpit is basically the two big fire lights. Anything else, it's dead until the engine come online or we have an external power source. So let me walk in the cockpit real quick. I'm gonna leave you guys here, and you're gonna hear a clicking noise coming from the air intakes. Those are the igniters, and that's the only thing that is able to basically work and hear, and we can hear from here on the ground. I'll be right back. And if you get closer to the air intake, you're going to be able to hear it.
Videoing.
That's one. And there's two. So they're redundant, and there's two batteries here. So one igniter work with one battery, the other igniter is connected to the second battery. So there's also a little bit of a redundancy there. As we were saying, main AC aircraft, though, we're gonna go more into that a little later. Let me go scoop over here. All right, so down here we will take a look at the nose gear bay. And back here we have the air intake for the air conditioning system. So the pack is inside this portion of the fuselage, and you can reach it from the top. Here, there's actually the oxygen reservoir. And on the two-seater, it's 10 liters liquid oxygen reservoir. And actually, let's see. I happen to have a screwdriver here, so let's see, I'm gonna show it to you. And it's a fairly neat system, obviously operated by an Air Force, that would be fairly easy. However, in a civilian world, it's kind of a pain because being liquid oxygen, it keeps boiling and it depletes it. So if you have a 10 liter oxygen right now filled up, it's gonna last 2 or 3 days, even if you don't use it, it keeps bleeding out. That's normal. That's a normal feature of this system. Although 10 liters of oxygen provide a whole lot of oxygen that can you can use it for the whole day if you needed to. That's why it was designed to use liquid oxygen. If we had to have the same quantity of oxygen in high pressure tanks, we would need hundreds of pounds of pressure tanks to hold all that oxygen. So basically, that's the system. There's an indicator in the cockpit, a couple of indicators in the cockpit. One is for the level of oxygen in liters. So we know how much oxygen there is inside the reservoir, liquid oxygen. And then the pressure, there's obviously an evaporator and a pressure reducer. So we get the usual 70 PSI or so for the oxygen system for the masks. And we can see the wiring for those probes, for those indicators. I'm gonna close this door, this compartment here, so I can show you. We get here to the air intake. Very curious design. This was one of a kind. At that time, it was even a secret. So it was covered right at the beginning of the F-104 era. It's a split three-dimensional air intake. So half of it is here, half of it obviously is on the other side. Single engine. The two airflow, they get together in the center of the fuselage before reaching the first stage of the engine, or before reaching the engine. The way they are shaped this way, it's because it's been designed, as we know, jet engines are not able to handle supersonic speeds. So the speed inside the air intake must be reduced to below the speed of sound. This was one of the genius design. It's called Ferry Cones, because of this engineer, Ferry, came out with this design, which has been extensively used as three-dimensional air intake on many other aircraft. One of them, it's the SR-71. They have this, the whole air intake in one, on each engine, instead of having it split on one side of the fuselage on the SR-71. And the cone is also movable. It moves back and forth to keep the air intake at the optimized, at the most efficient point of operation throughout the whole flight. These are not movable, these are fixed, and they're optimized to a number, to a specific window or speeds. Let's put it that way, but it does work in the whole supersonic scenario. Now let's go back why they design it this way. So the air needs to be slowed down. So what happens is when we are supersonic, there's a first shock wave that gets generated here, and there's a first deceleration of the air when it goes through the shock wave. It gets slowed down after the first shockwave. The second shockwave is 90 degrees here, and let's say Mach 2, the speed of the air inside the air intake, it's less than Mach 1, so let's say around 0.8 the speed of sound. So this design provides that in two shockwaves. So those two shockwaves break the energy down of the speed and change pressure and speed in a way that it's higher pressure and much lower speed here inside the air intake. Here, as if you can see it inside, there's also this opening right around the back of the cone, and that's done that way so it can actually eat the boundary layer that flows on this cone. So it gets sucked in there and spit out underneath the aircraft. Right, this is one, and that's the second one right there. So these two outlets, they spit out the boundary layer that it's on the cone there. That allows a much more efficient airflow around the surfaces or the inside of the intake. That all brought up the efficiency of this air intake very high. And just so you have an example, we have an example. Let's say we're traveling a Mach 2 at 50,000 feet. The air outside, we assume it's minus 56 or so degrees Celsius. So that's the outside air temperature. This air intake, other than here, it also starts helping the engine increasing the pressure more and more and lowering the speed before it gets to the first stage of the compressor. This air intake, for the way it's shaped, it does it so well that, just to have an idea, the air goes in, let's say, at minus 56 degrees Celsius, and by the time it reaches the engine at the first stage of the compressor, in just few feet, the air go, at Mach 2, the air goes from minus 56 to approximately plus 100 on this airplane, and the two-seater 150 degrees. So there's like 200 degrees jump because the air intake slows it down and increases the pressure so much that we have that jump of a temperature. It's quite impressive. Back here, the backside of the air intake on the two-seater, this aircraft, this is a FOD check door, so it can be unscrewed and you can open it to check the engine. In part of the more extensive checks on the ground. The single seat, the F-104 ASAM from the Italian Air Force, the most updated F-104 that was ever built, and it was updated all the way until the last version came out in the late 90s. I flew off of the manufacturing company that built them in Italy from Turin. I think it was 2001, one of the last one, 2002, one of the last one that came off of the manufacturing company that had been built there under license from Lockheed. That was the last update, the ASAM. They have an additional opening here to provide extra air to the engine for heavy takeoffs to help the aircraft on the ground roll. Why is that? Because this air intake is obviously very efficient in higher speeds. It's not that efficient, it's not very good at no speed at all, like on the runway, let's say, you know, static. So there's not very big a cross section, if you understand what I'm saying. So by opening those two shells, you can open a very big portion here of air intake to allow air to be sucked directly from the engine, and that would close by itself up at around 300 knots automatically when the air intake actually starts to becoming functional. Let's put it that way. So this is just a FOD check door. Now, since we mentioned before the avionic bay, let's go 1 second up there and I'll show you what we have in the avionic compartment. So here we go on the back side, behind the back seater, there's two avionics compartments. One is pressurized, one is not pressurized. And I'm gonna show you what we have inside. Not too much on the two-seater, because remember, the two-seater aircraft was meant to be a trainer aircraft, so not all of the equipment that the single seat had was included in this version. But we're gonna see what we have here so we have a better perspective of the aircraft. All right, so we are on top of the aircraft. That's the back seat and the frame for the back seat right here. As we say, these are the two avionics, or mainly the two main avionics compartment for this airplane. And as we were saying earlier, there's not really so much of it because of the basic purpose of this airplane, which was mainly basic training to be able to fly then the single seat operational. So what we have here, basically, that's one compartment, that's the other compartment. This is pressurized, that's not pressurized. This is the most sensitive equipment right here. Like we were saying, circuit breakers over there, and five main boxes, avionic boxes. There's more on the sides. These are actually those that are swappable very quickly. That's a military concept. So basically, this is like the UHF radio. This is the altitude encoder, air data computer, radar, amplifier, and some of the power supplies. That would be the inertial navigation system, which is in our shop right now. There's the three-axis computer back there, and some more on that side. Now, the quality of this design is that you can swap the boxes very quickly, so they are very easily replaced in case of need for a very little downtime between flights, let's say, that's talking during an operational usage of the aircraft. Back here, we can get to the basically the there's one more compartment that's not pressurized, but that's the air conditioning pressurization pack right here. It's actually up here, 1 and 2. That's the air comes off of the heat exchanger. So that's that part right here. There's one more current rectifier, voltage rectifier for the DC system, and that's about it up here. A couple of antennas on top of these compartments, and walk around, and we can admire, actually, we can take a look actually at the shape of the aircraft from this perspective here, which is pretty rare. It's a very neat picture over here. Actually, I'm gonna walk on it here for a small portion. These red cap here are the gravity field for the tanks. There's a main tank here in between the two air intakes, left and right. That's the main fuselage tank. Those are the wings. Right now we have the flaps on takeoff position and leading edge flaps on takeoff position. A lot of wiring and hoses, pneumatic system, are going through this back spine here. And that's the very peculiar detail of the aircraft. Okay, so from here I'm gonna come back down and we're gonna keep going around our airplane. All right, we've seen the air intake, we've seen this portion, nav lights here, leading edge flaps. As we were saying, they are in the takeoff position right now. We left them that way for some checks right after landing. They are electrically actuated. So leading edge and trailing edge, they're electrically actuated. There's a cable that goes, torsion cable that goes from one side to the other to make sure that the position of the leading edge and trailing edge flaps, they match right and left wing. Extremely sharp edge, and you can have an idea, maybe here, I mean, the wing is not even an inch out here thickness. So there's no fuel in the wings whatsoever. This is mainly structure and flight controls. So extremely sharp edges here. They usually were not even painted here at the right at the leading edge, and they are as sharp that you can actually cut an apple if you wanted to. There was actually a joke that was played quite a few times with people that came to look at the airplane in the Air Force during air shows and such. There's also a couple of funny tales. There's a record of stitches that a pilot got doing in a walk around, and then I believe it's 11 or 14. So actually a pilot I know, the flaps were on takeoff position like they are right now. So during the walk around, doing that movement to go underneath the main landing gear bay, he actually got a pretty bad cut on his head. And I think the record was in later years. It was early in 2000s. Either 11 or 14 stitches, so bad day for him that time. All right, so we go underneath, watching out for our heads. Landing gear system. Another very unique thing of this airplane. This aircraft was designed, these landing gears are a very complex design, and they were able to make a very strong landing gear that is able actually to fit in a very small quantity of airplane, or very little space. At that time, the design was from the Skunk Works, same team of the Skunk Works, so SR-71, U-2s and such. And the words of Mr. Kelly Johnson were that I want the most powerful and biggest engines available, and I want to wrap around it the minimum quantity of airplanes. So that's how this design came up. And obviously it left very little room for systems and accessories. Very difficult to work with most of the times. And they had to go through some designs to make some things possible, just like the landing gear. So the landing gear has these shafts here that basically swivel the landing gear, the wheel itself, in a way that it can fit forward here. Between the early version of the F-104 or the Canadian version, like the one we have inside, and the latest version, like the Italian Air Force version, they decided to swap and used a little bigger tires. They're just maybe half of an inch or an inch wider, and that didn't allow for the wheel to actually fit anymore in this landing gear door. So very curiously, it's a very, very small detail, but if you can see, there's a bubble here of just like an inch that they had to do in order to fit the new tires, more advanced tires that were lasting a little longer, and they provide a little more safety for higher, you know, speeds for takeoff and landing. This is the landing gear door, and as you can see, the forward one, when the landing gear is extended, because of this actuator comes out a little more, the landing gear doors are not able to close all the way, so they stay a little bit open like we see right now. All right, so now, since there's no pressure in the system, I'll be able to unlock the door and show you the inside of a bay. Here we go. And that's the inside of the bay. You can see there's not much room for the landing gear. Up here, they had to make a modification on the structure to fit the actual tire, the wheel. And you can see here, actually, there's some marks. So basically, the tire physically touches the door. That's the clearance you have inside the structure here. And as we were saying, the way that actuator, landing gear actuator, extends out when the landing gear are down, you can see the door are not able to close all the way. So they are locked in an intermediate position. I want to close this up again. The up lock is able to hold the weight of it even without pressure. Before going out, I'm going to show you this. This is also a very interesting feature here. This is called the liquid spring. It's basically the strut of the airplane, of the aircraft, of the main landing gear. What it does is provide shock absorption, and it also allows to be trimmed in a way that the aircraft has the correct height from the ground, depending on the payload of the aircraft. This liquid spring, so-called, it's basically there's no physical springs, but the strut is basically made by a very high pressure nitrogen and specific hydraulic fluid, and the pressure in here is 5,000 at rest, 5,000 psi. So it's a hell of a high pressure, and you can imagine, you know, there's not much surface to hold all that weight. This aircraft gross weight, we're around, you know, 27,000 or so pounds. Another small tale here about the landing gear system. You see those two arms here, those two shafts. They keep this wheel in the correct angle, and it swings it then when it goes inside. Now there's a tale about an event that happened in the early 2000s. A friend of mine, he was training in an Italian airbase in Italy, and they had a bird strike on a base turn. And you know, aircraft speed is probably around 230 knots at that point. So what happened is a very big bird hit right here on the main landing gear, and it broke this shaft. So what happens without this shaft, the wheel itself, when 90 degrees, swivel 90 degrees out, and you know, according to the checklist, they elected to, they were chased by another airplane, and then when they realized what happened, then they elected to eject. So that, I think that was one of the last ejection we had in Italy, which was obviously successful. Yeah, that was an interesting fact about this shaft here, that it's holding the tire the way it's supposed to be. So, you know, landing around 200 knots or so with the landing gear 90 degrees, then it's definitely strongly unsuggested. Going here, landing lights, one and two, one is, it's on the other leg. We talk about the liquid spring. We jump to this part here very quickly. This is the connection for the huffer. The huffer is the jet start, or the small APU, or ground power unit, I should call it, right there, that allowed the starting of the engine. There's no starter motor in the engine, or electric starter motor. There's a small turbine that is fed by this high pressure airflow provided by that jet generator that allows the engine to be spun up to around 10-12%. Fuel can be provided in the igniters, and then these jet star will assist the starting, the spool up from that point to around 35-38%. At that point, the air is cut out and the engine is self-sufficient, and it's gonna stabilize around 67% RPM. When the engine started, they obviously take off the hose and the connection, and then the five fingers check, or the ground check, starts for the ground crew. All right, let's walk around. Actually, since we're here, we can take a look around the underneath of the wing. This is a wing off of the G model, like we were saying. Not many attachments here other than two of them, one on each wing, which will be this one here and one on the other side. They allow a load of around 1,500 pounds each, and it was usually used for tanks, two more external tanks to hold 1,400 pounds each. 14-14, and then the wingtip tanks, which are 11 and 11 approximately. Other payloads were able to be carried, and they were more used in the earlier years when I was not around yet. And the aircraft was used for training on more advanced type of tactical operations. So this so-called BL-75 attachment and the rack, we still use it, not so much for fuel anymore, but nowadays it's used mainly to carry payloads that need to be tested, mainly off of the Kennedy Space Center in the restricted areas, for sensor probes and equipment that need to be tested at specific air speeds and altitudes. One of the things that we do, it's hypersonic testing. So we provide a test bench, a supersonic test bench, since we can sustain up to Mach 2 on this airplane, Mach 2.2 in the single seater, for very long extended length of time. That's why we still use this attachment on this airplane. The single seat we've seen on another session, it actually has three attachments per wing. It's going to be the BL-75. There's going to be a so-called BL-104, which it's so substantially the inches off of the center line of the aircraft, right here, which this aircraft doesn't have it for more payloads. And obviously the wingtip attachments. That's also a station that can be utilized. Not so much on the two-seater, although technically can be done. The two-seater has very little fuel inside the fuselage, around 5,500 pounds of fuel. So this 1100 per side, 2200, makes a big of a difference. Although we have attachment for the wingtip, instead of using the wingtip tanks, we can actually carry more attachment for more payloads. So the two-seater would have the BL-75 right here underneath the wing, and the attachment at the wingtips. The single seat has one more set of attachment here per wing, and then of course the center line attachment just underneath the fuselage. All right, since we're here, we're gonna take a short shortcut here to the huffer -60. What this is basically a small jet engine, like those you find in bigger airplanes, like airliners. The small additional engine that it's on the ground to guarantee power and air conditioning system. So this is what this is, and what it does is once you start it up, you have the ability to provide high pressure
air through that hose to start up the engine. So the crew chiefs, basically, there will be one in front of the aircraft looking at the pilot, and he will relay the information to this person here, to this crew chief, because the starter of the aircraft itself, or the engine, it's, as we were saying, a small turbine that receives the air from it. You engage it at zero speed, obviously. The pilot can see the RPM of the engine, around 10% or so. It provides fuel, moving the throttle to idle, and the igniters, switches on the igniters. At that point, the engine fires, and it starts helping spooling itself up. At that point, it's 1%. When you see the pilot showing the fingers, that means that 1%, 20%, 30%, 35, at 38, with that motion, it shows the lead crew chief that relays the information to the crew chief operating the starting unit to cut the pressure, because you don't want to overspeed that small turbine. And after that, after 38% or so RPM, the engine is self-sustains itself, and it's able to spool up all the way to 67%, like we were saying, which is the idle RPM. Okay, tip tanks, we were saying Mach 2 tank, Mach 2 external tank, it's quite of a number. I should clarify, in the two-seaters, Mach 1.8, Mach 2 on the single-seater. So 1,100 pounds or so of fuel contained in it, and all of the external loads, payloads of the aircraft are jettisonable in flight. Something, if need be, obviously, in case of emergency, of an early landing because of some events that happens or some system malfunctions. You want to be light as possible to come back and land in case of some specific malfunction, electrical, flaps, hydraulics, and so forth. Not so much a factor here because we usually fly the aircraft in a quite light configuration, but more former Air Force flights and missions, you know, full of fuel and weapons, those were quite interesting days. A nice fact about a single seat, gross weight, it's almost around the 30,000 pounds on the single seat. You can have rotation speed above 230 knots or so, lift off 235, very close to the limit of the tires. That's a hell of a speed to be still on the ground. And runways usually are much shorter than what we can have here at the Space Center. We can count on 15,000 foot runways.
Go.
All right, going over here, more nav lights, stabilization system for the wingtip tanks, and the backside of the wing. The flight controls are hydraulic operated with the two redundant hydraulic system over the two main hydraulic pumps of the engine, which provide 3,000 pounds PSI, 3,000 PSI of pressure in the system. Interesting enough, these wings are so thin that they don't allow, obviously, any fuel. There's no fuel in the wings here. And there's not enough space for a normal or standard actuator to provide enough force to operate the system or any of the flight controls. So what they had to come out with is they had to fit the biggest actuator they could, which they are actually very small, but to allow to provide enough force that was required for supersonic flights and the whole envelope of the F-104, they had to put 10 actuators just to operate one single aileron. We can see them now without pressure, we're able to move them a little bit. And you can see here, those are 10 actuators, hydraulic actuators, that actuates the aileron. Five are powered by one system, five are powered from the other system. And so that's an interesting fact. And they are displayed right here. There's a part of the flight controls as well here. We're moving on the flap system. Right now we see them in the takeoff position. When they go all the way down in the landing position, there's a PLC system on these flaps, which is the boundary layer control system. There's high pressure air being bled by the 17 stages of the engine, 17 stage compressor, very high pressure, high temperature air that gets blown on the back side of the flap because it's much more lower than this position. That allows the boundary layer to stick on the back side of the flap and allow the aircraft to fly. That is also the reason why you cannot go below 83% anytime the flaps are extended in landing position because of the BLC system. So you don't want the air not to be enough to hold the boundary layer on the backside of the flaps. Otherwise, you could lose one at a time and you would have basically an uncontrolled rolling motion of the aircraft. So until you're all the way on the ground, you touch down on the runway, you cannot retard the throttle less than 83%. Guarantee there's enough pressure and airflow on the backside of it. Here, these are auxiliary cooling ports. and if you can come down here, I can show you a little better. Well, they are basically, they're spring-loaded, and the engine itself is fit in a way that forward, there's a small gap between the engine and the air intake.
So as we were saying, inside the engine bay, it's a little noisier now, but obviously we are in an airport, there's a lower pressure inside the engine bay. So that's why they are kept open by the engine sucking more air. When the air intake becomes operational at more than 300 knots or so, the positive pressure in the air intake pressurizes also the engine bay, so they automatically close. And that's why you see them closing fly. When you fly formation and you're around 300 knots, which is kind of a lower side of the speed, you see them open and close, like fluctuating like that. More than 350 knots or so, they're always closed. We're gonna go here on the back and see the nozzle real quick. Back section here, this is the speed brake. There's one speed brake on each side of the airplane, hydraulically operated, 3000 PSI obviously. There's no limit for speed or any limit within the whole envelope of the aircraft. When we are on the other side, I'm gonna tell you a nice story about that one too. Tail of the aircraft, it's been built by with magnesium and titanium. You can see the two different colors of it. The nozzle, this system here, there's two sets of nozzle, the internal one, the primary and secondary one, or the internal and the external ones. What they do is they modify the area of the exhaust. Why is that? That's a normal jet engine, which is fit with an afterburner section, or an afterburner, right here. And you can see inside it, if you get closer, you can see inside, that down there is the flame holder. You can barely probably see the turbine behind it. After the turbine, there's a bunch of sprayers, and that structure there, that's called the frame holder. When you're full power on the engine, you can select the afterburner. What that is raw fuel is sprayed on after the turbine, where there's basically almost no limit for temperature. That fuel is then ignited by a torch, which is right there, and that additional fuel, a whole lot of fuel, provides so much more thrust, and that's the afterburner section. Because of the additional fuel pressure and volume of hot gases coming out, this system here allows the geometry and area to be changed, and that is done to keep the temperature of the turbines actually within certain limits, because this counter pressure here on the backside of the engine has also consequences of the other side of the engine before the afterburner. So this section here modulates and keep the maximum allowable temperature in the turbines, and yet try to have the maximum amount of fuel on this back section here, and the fastest speed for the hot gases coming out, which at the end of the day will provide more thrust. That's the tail, obviously, a very big control surface. There's no trim tabs on any side of the airplane, supersonic surfaces, so the whole surface moves whether you're using the trim or the flight control. So when you move the trim for the pitch, for example, the whole stabilizer moves. Over here, the other side of the speed brake, the left side, so what I was going to tell you earlier on the other side was a little noisier. There's no limit of speed or envelope where you can use the speed brake. And there's a note on the flight manual that says, literally, extreme drag can be experienced at speeds with the use of speed brakes at speed more than 1.75. And that's actually something that pilots are trained on the basic training that I did a few years ago in Italian Air Force. The aircraft, when you accelerate on one of the first rides closer to Mach 2, then you open the speed brake at Mach 1.75. And that's like jumping on the brakes on a highway, more than that, on a race car. And you're literally like thrown on the instrument panel and held by the seat belts. Quite impressive. Down here, more inlet for the cooling system, the cooling, additional cooling we were talking about at lower speeds. That's obviously the bottom part of the engine. This is the hydraulic system. So the way they fit these, it's quite interesting. This system here have the main control valve for the hydraulic system and the two accumulators, and everything is actually swinging here on this door. It's been mounted on this door. And what really got me when I was a younger pilot training on the F-104 back at school, it's a very complex system, and they put the most complex part of the hydraulic system on the actual door. So if I unlock it, basically this system, it's all swinging around this swiveling connection here, 3000 PSI system. So the beauty of it is that they can open it up when we do the startup and the five fingers check after startup before taxiing, the hydraulic system can be checked in basically all the main features. And then when it's all done, the engine bay is closed and the hydraulic system becomes part of the airplane. Although everything is functional even when it's open. It always got my attention. Down here, these are the level of the two hydraulic system reservoir, number one and number two. Number two is bigger because other than the flight controls has also most of the systems, the other systems. This indicates the level. Why it's like that? Because the reservoirs are under pressure and they are, the oil is enclosed in a bladder type of reservoir. So not only is under pressure, but it also works in any type of acceleration or zero G scenario. So you never run out of oil, hydraulic oil or hydraulic fluid in the system. That would be very bad news for an aircraft that is fully hydraulic controlled. That's here on the back. There's an emergency UHF antenna enclosed here in this center spine that it's underneath the aircraft, provides additional stability at high speed. The two-seat, the single seat, has also two additional strikes here on the side that provides additional stability and speeds above Mach 2. Behind it, we can see the arresting hook. That's not for landing on aircraft carriers, obviously. That would be quite interesting to see. But it's an emergency hook that can be lowered in case of some type of malfunction. Most of the military bases, they have so-called barriers, and this specific case would be a steel wire at the beginning and or at the end of the runway. Let's say if an hydraulic failure, you might end up having no brakes, although there is a parachute drag chute system, which we're going to talk in a second. You can lower that cable, that hook, and you can engage the cable and the aircraft can be stopped. Depending on the weight, you can engage that cable the speed at speeds all the way up to 170 knots or so, more or less, depending on the barrier and the loads or the payloads or the weight of the aircraft. Another interesting feature, that's what we said, one of the only DC system that can be lowered or utilized even with no power on the aircraft. Drag chute. We're not going to be able to see it right now, but it's enclosed right here. In a normal scenario, with the runways at less than 5,000 feet, you would use the drag chute to slow the aircraft down. Otherwise, you would go to sets of brakes way too quickly. It's a mechanically actuated, so you pull a cable that pull out a safety pin inside here. This door opens and the drag chute is deployed. Turn it 90 degrees and pull it additional few more inches, it unlock it to leave it on the runway for the personnel then to bring it back. Otherwise, when you taxi back, you end up ruining it. When you pull the drag chute, the hook lowers few inches, because otherwise this door wouldn't be open. So that's another trick of this design and solution they had to come out with to try to fit things in the little room that they had. We're gonna come up on this side of the airplane right here. Left side of the aircraft, heat exchanger to lower down the temperature of the super hot air that it's bled from the 17th stage of the compressor of the J79, General Electric J79-11B, which is mounted on this aircraft. 17th stage, the air comes out at an extremely high temperature. It's the temperature is slowed down, it's lowered a little bit through the heat exchanger inside the engine bay before going on the pressurization and air conditioning pack that we saw earlier. Trailing edge flap, aileron again. We go through here and through our wingtip, more nav lights. 1,100 pounds of fuel or so on the left wingtip as well. Leading edge flaps, and we talk about the landing gear. We can see the tire. Let's talk about that for a second. You see, like, it looks like, you know, for somebody that drives a car, it's used to normal vehicles, that might not look very in good shape. However, it is actually in very good shape. This landing gear, this wheel, this tire only had a few landings. These threads here are wearing threads, so they're not really structural, and there's a number of them that you go through during normal landings. And there's these marks here, if you can see them, these dips, there's a number of them on each side of the tire. Until they're at least, if you see them consecutively, the tire is still good. When you don't see one of them, it's still good as long as the one before and after is still visible. When you don't see two consecutive dips, then the tire has reached its limit and needs to be replaced. which happen quite often. Landing at these speeds on this runway, which is very rough, a new tire allows probably 5 to 7 landings. And a tires that runs about $1,200 each, you know, it's kind of an expense, if you imagine. All right, let's go on. Left 50% of the air intake. We talked about it earlier. Single point pressure refueling system. There's a small door here that you can open and select the single tanks the way you want to be filled up, whether you want to have only internal or also the wingtip tanks. This one here used to be theoretically the gun bay. No two-seater were actually equipped with it other than one that we actually have. So the additional room here was fit with additional fuel, only a few hundred pounds of fuel here. But that really, having that little fuel and having an engine so thirsty, it made a difference, so it helped. Single seat wise, this portion here is actually utilized after the ASAM, the last modification they did on that airplane. They took the gun out and they fitted the semi-active missile avionics all the way down there, which is basically a high frequency transmitter that used the antenna of the radar to shoot the continuous wave to the target, which then bounce back to the semi-active missiles and is able to follow it. That was called the Klystron system. And it was here, actually we have it on the single seat. We're gonna see that in the next walk around when we're gonna where we're gonna do the shooting on the single seat. All the way here in the front, this is the other angle of attack probe. This one here it talks to the three-axis computer and the APC system, but it doesn't provide any angle of attack indication. This is the supersonic portion of the system. So it provides shaker indication for the supersonic portion of the flight. Ejection, the canopy jettison. So if you open this door, there's a handle you can pull a few feet away from the aircraft in case you have to rescue or enter the cockpit from the ground if you're unable to open it normally. And we're back to the radome, and kind of a long walk around, but you got to see some of the features or interesting points about the F-104, the two-seater today. We're gonna go inside the cockpit, so we're gonna show you a little bit inside of it, with or without power, so you see what goes on or not on, having or not having the power connected to the aircraft or the engine running. So here we are in the cockpit. That's of the two-seater. We have a couple of modifications I'm going to show you around. We do have power to the aircraft right now. That's what this noise is. So we'll be able to see a few of the systems working at least. All right, so here we go. Basically, this is how it looks like right now by sitting here in the cockpit. From the back here, most of the things are the same, like this side right here. With the dampers, fuel, and auxiliary trims, emergency UHF radio, UHF, no radar, at least the panel is not there, although the radar is on the airplane. Flap and throttle, that's military. That's first AB sector, and that's full AB right here. Again, military, idle, cutoff. Landing gear handle, lights, and brake systems. These are additional lights that we can see a little closer here. And so there's the trim lights basically and the anti-skid light over there. These are the two igniters. When I start them like that, there's a 30 seconds of clicking from the sparkers. We can probably barely hear it. I don't know, there's a little windy today. Over here, landing gear and external stores. Flaps indication, which is up, both of them. So as we were saying, all the external stores capability is being retained, as well as the controls for it. So because those are used in some of the R&D missions that we fly with external stores mounted on the airplane. Hook, that's how you check the system and that's how you deploy it. And here there's the main part of the panel. I'm gonna take these off. These are the leg restraints. So we can see a little better. I'm moving to the right and then going a couple of more details. And all the way down here. So going back to the center, we had to move a few instruments around, but we figured out that this current layout works fine for us. G-meter, AOA, equivalent angle of attack, UHF radio, VHF radio, that's the standard original anemometer and MAC indicator, altimeter, standby horizon, VSI engine instruments over here. And then we have we added two indicators here. This is voltages for the two main emergency or the two only batteries on the airplane. The two new G5s connected to the G650 ADS-B and GPS system. And over here, fuel, oxygen. I'm sorry, fuel, cabin altitude, hydraulic, oxygen, warning panel. That's with all the indications. And the slow light, any gear unsafe, aileron and rudder unlimited, and IFF mode 4, that one there is deactivated. There's no IFF mode 4 right now installed on the aircraft. Here, everything is standard. The radar console, it's been taken out. I should call it the screen. Although it's the aircraft is cabled, although the aircraft is wired for it, and the radar is still in the radome. On the east side here, oxygen panel, pressure suit panel, the iPad which is connected to the G650 and was USB and cigarette lighter for other accessories that we might use in the cockpit. This part is basically remained the same, you know, with the lightning, air conditioning system, and so forth. Back here, there's a control for the air refueling probe, never used, and a switch here that would allow to control the jet start, the cart, for starting the engine. Although we do always we do all those operations visually with our crew chiefs. Right here, there's a couple of switches. The way we lay these out is that we were able to add a VHF radio, which is a different impedance for the audio side, but we integrated that with the original UHF system, meaning that at the touch of a switch, this one right here, we can select one system or the other. In other words, if we are on UHF, our UHF radio is active, and that would work with the original push-to-talk on the throttle, and this is the repeater for the frequency. The intercom would work as well, which is right here, and that would be part of the UHF system. If we flip this switch in VHF, this radio is active, and it's actually we had to custom build an impedance adapter, so the aircraft sees this radio just like a UHF radio or military standard radio with military impedances. So the intercom of this radio is now active. It works between the two cockpits, and we were also able to funnel in the audios from the UHF and from the horns and the warnings of the aircraft to the audio in of the VHF system, so we don't lose any of those, basically. So in other words, when we use the VHF system, we can still obviously talk to each other. We can hear the warnings from the airplane, from the aircraft, and we can also monitor the UHF. VHF push-to-talk, we use this one right here. So now we have two push-to-talks. This one for the VHF and the original one on the throttle for the UHF. This is the original avionics panel to take control of the avionics. Right now we have control of the radar, the UHF, the TACAN, and the nav system from the front cockpit. If we were to sit in the back cockpit and we would flip those toggles and we would get the green light in the back, it means that they would have in the back seat the control of those systems, meaning that the UHF radio, for example, if they take the control from the back seat, this is the panel that would be active at that moment in time. All the original T-handles are still there. This is the drag chute release, the manual landing gear handle, the rammer turbine, and the emergency nozzle closure. Right here, this is the canopy jettison, and this is the pedal adjustment. The six handles, they need to be all in. That's part of the cockpit checks. So I'm gonna move now on the left side here, and I'm gonna show you the connection. This is a life support connection, oxygen and audio for the helmet. Moving down here, that's a Martin Baker plate of the ejection seat. which has the comm here that goes to the hose we just saw. This is the anti-G connection, and this is the pressure suit connection for the flights with the partial pressure suit. We're gonna go and see how the canopy works. The canopy works completely manual in the normal mode, let's call it that way. So there's like this push button here that needs to be pushed to release it. And then the canopy sits a little bit open, which is, this is how most of the time we taxi, and the aircraft used to be taxied, because it allows a breeze to come in during taxi, because with low power setting, these systems don't allow for so much air conditioning. So at low power setting, especially on the ground, the canopy, it's either open or cracked open like this. To close it, that's the main lever right here. And we're gonna see some hooks. There's three of them, one, two, and three on the back, that are gonna grab it and hold it down. And there they are, one, two, and three on the back. Now the canopy is closed. There's also an inflatable seal all around it. Now it's not inflated because the pneumatic system is not on since the engine is not running. To open it, it's the other way around, so we push forward, and that's how we crack it open. Again, a very good position to be when you're taxiing or after landing, so you get a very good breeze coming in here, which makes you feel very good after a hot day here in Florida. Here in front, as you can see, looks like an Indy car, I guess, or a Formula One car. You have a very narrow side in the front. This is heated, and only the last one is, left side is heated, because it was designed to be able to fly in formation even in adverse weather, and they assumed that the wingman would be on the right side. So this is heated, those are not heated, although I never had issues with ice, to tell you the truth. And actually, when you go supersonic, quite high speed, more than 1.6 or 7, these actually get warm just before the friction with the air. That's pretty interesting. I'm gonna open the canopy all the way. You wanna push it up and not let it go until it locks. And now it's locked, so it doesn't come down unless you push the release out there. That's about it. I'm gonna kick the power off of the external power unit so we can have an idea of what we have going on only with the batteries, which is basically almost nothing. I'm gonna show you in a second. So we're back in the cockpit, much quieter now. There's no power to the aircraft, and we do have power to the two batteries are connected. So these two batteries, this is an aircraft that can do much at all, unless there's an external power unit or the engine is running. Hook release, the igniters, the fire light system. So if I test it, this is the only thing I see, the two red lights there. The fire light. So those are the only DC system on this airplane, basically, are the one that I'm showing you now, that work off of the battery. This is an aircraft, however, that even in flight, if all the power, electrical power, is lost, the aircraft will keep flying normally with basically only few limitations, like landing gear extension has to be done differently, but it will work, or the flap extension. Other than that, the engines and the flight controls would just keep working absolutely fine. All right, now we're gonna get out and we're gonna say a couple of words about the ejection seat. So this is the ejection seat. What we're seeing here is a Martin Baker IQ-7A ejection seat, which is a 0-0 seat, meaning that would work from the ground. Actually, on the two-seater, there's a 60 knots limitation to allow separation with the canopies in case there's two ejections at the same time. It's been upgraded from the C2, Lockheed C2 seats. And even before that, the original seat, which was actually a downward ejection seat, believe it or not, because the original technology wasn't allowing a seat that was going to eject upwards to clear and allowing the clearance of the tail. So that's why they went for that option at the beginning. The ejection happened pulling either the main handle over here or the one in the middle of the legs on the bottom side of the seat. They would do exactly the same thing. They would do exactly the same thing, with the difference that this one on top here, when it's pulled, it deploys a face shield or a cover for the face to protect for a blast at very high speed, if that was the case, of an ejection at very high speeds. Another couple of features is that there's a barostatic system that, in case an ejection happens at very high altitude, so if the pilot wants to eject at a high altitude, let's say 30,000 feet, the seat would keep the pilot on the seat itself, and it would stabilize the fall with the drag chute, and there's an oxygen bottle on the side that will keep oxygen flowing through the mask of the pilot. That would happen all the way to, depending on the settings, between 10,000, 15,000 feet. That's when the sequence would start again and the seatbelt separation would happen. At that point, the pilot gets separated from the seat, and he would stay with the parachute, which is this section right here. So the seat would get away, and the pilot and the parachute for the pilot would open, and then the pilot at that point would come down just with the parachute and the survival kit underneath the legs. Okay, here we are. Thank you for being with us today. I hope I wasn't that boring. I tried to make it as efficient as possible. Hopefully we got to know the F-104 a little better, and thankfully we're still flying it today. It's an extremely unique aircraft and with a very unique envelope. It's a masterpiece that I'm very glad that the company is still being able to keep in operation and useful for many entities out there, including test pilot training. I want to thank you, Sean, Gary, Bill, our crew chiefs, director of maintenance, and Matt, our director of public relations. And hopefully we'll see you soon. We're gonna have more to come. We're gonna talk about the single seat, the extra features of that airplane, and a few more flight videos, which I guess you're gonna enjoy even more. Thank you again, guys, and I'll see you soon.